Do you know that most married couples never talk about money before they get married? They never talk about money during the marriage, and they often don't talk about money at the end of the marriage. That was a striking thing. It's from a study that was done by T.R. Price and Fidelity. Why aren't people talking about money? I mean, if you're going to marry someone, you should talk about money. It should be brought up. It should be a conversation. If I ever get married again, I'm going to know her credit score. I'm going to know how much money she has put away in her 401k. I'm going to know herself. This is important information if you're going to be married and create a legal contract. And this is just to illustrate to you how people don't talk about money. They don't talk about it to their intended spouse. They don't talk about it to their children. And this is one of the bad things, because when my daughter was getting credit, I put her on one of my credit cards and she got a credit score like 720 in 2 months. You know how many people don't know that? There is a bunch of people who know about an authorized user, but there's so many people who don't know about that. Do you know there's a health savings account which can offset your taxes? There are so many things that we need to talk about with money that leave unsaid and undiscussed. So the first thing to changing your financial blueprint or your financial DNA is to discuss money, to discuss how much who's making. Like, I mean, I want you to think about it. You met this girl, beautiful. She moves your heart in a certain way. You're intimate. You're having sexual relations, but you never bring up money. And this is really, really bad. This is a bad situation, because going to my other channel, Savage Finance, if you're a couple and you're getting married, you should live on one income. I know that many people feel that that's implausible and it's impossible, but it's not. If you live on one income, you're going to be financially fruitful. And one of the things that is happening is people are getting married without a deep analysis into debt, a deep analysis into credit, a deep analysis into cash reserves. You know, if you're a woman who's marrying quote unquote a baller, you already know where he stands, but I guarantee you he has no clue to where you stand. None whatsoever. Take Cam Newton, NFL quarterback, went to the Super Bowl. He got with a stripper who is now trying to take him to the cleaners. And one of the things about changing your financial DNA, your financial blueprint, is understanding that when you commingle funds, that's what you're doing when you're getting married, it's a commingling of funds. There should be a plan. There should be a discussion, and there should be goals, and there should be an agenda, and there should be thoughts of what we're going to do. I'm going to give you a blueprint to change your financial DNA. Let's say your name is Alan and you met Carla, and you and Carla are getting prepared to get married. This is one of the first things you need to do after. Well, actually, you should have a read on this before you even ask Carla to marry you. Once you get serious, whatever that means, whatever timetable that is for you, you need to say, hey, boo, let's sit down and talk about money. I love you. I think we should move in together. And with that comes a commingling of funds, and we need to move together with a plan and an agenda so that both of us are better off. That's the key. That's how you sell this. So how much do you make? What's your credit score? How much debt do you have? And this is key. This is key. My gentlemen, my dudes, once you say those three little words, I love you, there is a comprehensive effect in a woman's mind. When you say, I love you, her burdens are now your burdens. Not necessarily your burdens are her burdens, but definitely her burdens are yours. So this is why you need to have this conversation, so you know what you're getting yourself into. Typically, you'll sit down with your boo and discuss it and come up with a roadmap. Let's say your intended boo has $20,000 worth of debt and you have no debt whatsoever. The plan is, okay, what we're gonna do, you're gonna get out your apartment, and all of the money that you were paying to your apartment, you're gonna apply that money to your debt. And I'll go ahead and pay the rent here. And then once your debt is done, then I want you to take that same amount of money, since she's not used to getting it, and put it in a joint checking account for us. Now, if the woman is really resistant or hesitant, This should tell you how far you should go with this woman, because you just said, I'm gonna pay these bills while you take your money and get rid of your debt. And once your debt is retired, then I want you to put money in an account for us since we're working together as a team. If she is resistant, this is one of my dating questions I used to ask. Hey, you know, I was just thinking in the future, you're a lovely girl. What if we were married and I came home and said, I have this amazing idea. We're gonna live on one income and we're going to live on the biggest income and we're going to save the second income. And if you get any resistance to this plan, that should let you know what you are working with and how hard and how challenging it's going to be going down the road. Because if you're dealing with someone that is not receptive to sound, practical financial advice, there's ego, there's attitude. There will be ego and attitude in other areas. I'm just here to tell you. So essentially, this should be one of your vetting questions, because if you cannot talk about money openly and honestly with someone you're in love with, that's going to be a problem down the road. One of the situations that I had was I was dealing with someone who had massive student loan debt, and she kind of figured out how much money I was making. And it became this situation of me paying off her debt. And I was just sitting there like, I'm not gonna do that. And there's other things I'm not gonna get into, but essentially when you're dealing with someone who has like issues, like if you're in a relationship with someone that has a lot of debt, this is not a reason to end the relationship. But what you should do is sit down and create a plan to retire that debt. And if the person with the debt is not receptive to that plan, letting you know what you're working with. Because this is one of the things. Because during this study, they found out that people who were getting married were not discussing money. These same people were going to produce children that they were not going to discuss money with. They were not going to teach them the lessons they've learned. They were not going to school them. They were not going to jumpstart their credit. They were going to do none of this stuff. This is where it starts. If you have this conversation with your intended spouse and break it down, and you both should sit down and create a spreadsheet. You should sit down and create a plan for getting out of debt, because now you have two incomes. Now, one of the things is, if you are a man and you have a sizable income and there's a discussion of children, this woman's gonna wanna stay at home. And there's really nothing wrong with that if you have picked the right one. And I'm about to give you a plan on how to make that a workable and fair and equitable situation to you. So you meet this woman, you're getting married, you love her, and you make a sizable income. What she should do is take her whole income and put it in a joint checking account where you both can benefit. And you, since you make a sizable income, maybe you're an entrepreneur, maybe you're an investor, then you would know what to do with that money to make it grow so you can benefit from her income. Because typically people get married 2 to 3 years before they have children so they can enjoy each other before having children. So her income should go into an account for 2 or 3 years. So this is a way that you can get economic benefit from her financial contributions, because there are so many women that want the man to be the man, but they don't want to be a lady. They don't want to be the woman. There are many women who want to get married, but they're not interested in being a wife, because being a wife comes with a lot of responsibility, a lot of duties. When I was a kid, there was these neighbors I would go visit, Mr. and Mr. Lanier. And at times I could tell that Mrs. Lanier was pissed at Mr. Lanier. But you know what? She still cooked dinner. She still cleaned the house. She still did her wifely duties, even though she was mad. And that taught me a lot about how you should work in a relationship. Even when you're mad, you should do your husbandly or wifely duties, because in the long run, you're only gonna be mad for a temporary time. And once this whole hostility of stop doing certain things, that will tell you what you're working with. So one of the things that I want you guys to understand is we need to start discussing money. We need to come up with agendas and plans, and we need to be open and honest about the situation of money. Because one of the things that you need to understand and you need to get a handle on is a discussion of money, a discussion of income, a discussion of economic empowerment, a discussion of a financial agenda, and the discussion of how to make money grow. There is this channel, iRich Journey. These two people, a married couple, are members of the FIRE community, and they've been able to retire and live in Portugal. They worked together. And there are many married couples out there who are not working together. He's an independent entity, she's an independent entity, and they kind of split the bills. But if they were to sit down, draft out a plan, and focus their money in the appropriate places, they would be so much better off. And it just shocked me and just stunned me that based upon this survey, how many people were getting married and not talking about money. This is something that I've been doing for years. I brought it up because like I said, going back to my dating question, if you and I were married and I said we wanted to live on one income, and I would just sit back and listen to what they would say. Anything other than that, the relationship was going to be short-lived because I was dealing with someone who was hostile to practical, sound advice. Hostile. Maybe they weren't raised right. Maybe they don't know what they know. Because one of the things is, as a masculine, dominant man, I'm a leader. I put together things. I create things. I create outcomes. And if I'm dealing with a woman who is not receptive, who is not open, who is not submissive, it ain't gonna work. It's not gonna work because when you're dealing with someone who, based upon their person, that feels that they have inalienable rights, that feel that perhaps that we are equal, and this is a conversation I have with any woman I'm dating. You and I are not equal. We're not. I am an advanced, I am a moneyed individual. You are not. We're not equal. If you cannot respect and acknowledge that and play your position, we will not be together. Because this is how you get women. Tell you this story. My ex-wife used to work for this company, and I remember taking her to work, and this guy who started the company brought his wife in. This is something you should never do. You should not ever bring your wife in to run stuff unless she's capable and competent. Not because she's your wife, now she gets to run stuff. And this chick became a Nazi. And she, while I was there, said, I am the boss of you. She was telling this founder of a company that brought her in what was gonna go on. She was rough riding employees. She was pissing everyone off. And I was just sitting there like, God, that's just a bad deal. You should never, ever put someone in charge of people who is incapable of leading. You can kill your company. And you know, I Googled it. They're not together anymore. Surprise, surprise. Because essentially this woman thought that she was on the same level as this founder dude when she wasn't. He put her in a position of positional leadership, not based upon merit nor ability. It didn't work out. I don't even think the company is in existence anymore. But I want you guys to start having these conversations about money. I want you guys to start thinking about money. I want you guys to really investigate, and also be sure to subscribe to Savage Finance so you can get your financial education. And for those of you who are ready to take it to another level, this month I am building out the Corporate Toolbox. It is going to be to teach you how to run a corporate agenda, how to start, structure, and scale a company, plus the legal entity, plus how to run it. There's going to be a lot of goodness in there. You can get in for $150 a month for 16 payments, or as $2,400. And this special ends end of September. So the link's below. Go ahead and get a piece of that action. And I will see you guys in the next video.